Okay, today, as I described moments ago, we will talk about critical section problem, simple solutions, hardware solutions, mutual exclusions, semaphores, and monitors. Synchronization problem is an interesting problem and comes up in many areas, regardless of operating system concepts on operating system problems. It comes in any area, such as in robotics as well. We are going to introduce the concept of process synchronization. Then we will talk about critical section problem, solutions of hardware solutions, and the software solutions to critical section problem. And we will give some examples. The idea of running concurrently multiple CPUs on the same task or different tasks has been long a problem. Sometimes there is a tool where both CPU needs to access, and the state of the tool changes from time to time. So we need to synchronize these CPUs so that tool can be shared efficiently and without any significant problem. There will be some contention, there will be some compromise, but there should not be crashes or failures due to sharing information between two processes or two CPUs. When you have one CPU, you may have multiple processes. This is also possible, usually the case. So your CPU works for this process and then for this process. Again, this process may have a resource as a tool that is also used by the P2, by the other process. So that means that tool is shared between two different processes. If there is something shared, if you have something shared, and if you are executing concurrently, then you need to coordinate the shared item. If you don't coordinate the shared item, then the value of the shared item or the content of the shared item can be incorrect. So it will cause problems. So typical problem of shared data is one process puts data to the shared box, the other one receives from the shared box. So that is called as producer-consumer problem, sometimes consumer-producer problem. This one says consumer-producer problem, but actually it is producer-consumer problem. How do we do it? P1 keeps producing. P2 keeps consuming. Consuming means processing. So this guy say take, this guy says, let me get it. So this value is transferred from P1 to P2, which is in the memory. So that is the, that is in the memory. If you have only one piece of location, then you need to consume something. You check for an item. If the item is not available, you wait. Here, you produce something. You want to put it, but the location is full. Since the location is full, that means it has not been consumed yet, then this will wait. Obviously, at the end, speed of P1 must be comparable to speed of P2. So if both sides are processing numbers, processing data at relatively at the same speed, but with some variations, then it will work. If P1 is producing too many data, then P2 is able to consume. P1 will wait a lot. On the other hand, if P2 is fast, P1 produces data, but P2 is so fast, so it waits after consuming because there is no new data. If the speed is comparable, then we can assume that it will work. But the speed is relatively same with some variations. If this is the speed, and if the speed P2 is different, what is the solution? The solution is to use buffer. Buffer of size n. If you have a buffer of size n, if n is large enough, it may compensate the variations between processes P1 and P2. But at the end of the day, again, the speeds must be comparable. Otherwise, buffer will be bigger and bigger and bigger, and then it will reach its limit, and other side will consumer. The producer will wait again. So at the end, two sides must be relatively close to each other in terms of performance, but with some fluctuations. This is classical producer-consumer problem. That could be solved without buffer. If you don't have a buffer, then you wait. If you have a buffer, you wait for the you don't wait for the fluctuations, but the, if the absolute speed is different, you will wait after the buffer is full, or if after buffer is empty, it may never get filled because consumer is very fast. So this is our producer code. In the producer code, there is an infinite loop, theoretically an infinite loop. Here you do something with the data processing, you produce something, and you wait for the buffer. So pay attention to this. While counter is equal to buffer size, that means buffer is full. If counter is not equal to buffer size, that means counter is less than buffer size. Then you can move. At that time, buffer is filled with the next item, put, and then increase the buffer size, increase the buffer pointer location, and increment the counter. Why do we use percent here? Because we have a ring buffer. This ring buffer has n elements. One of them shows out. There is a buffer size. Buffer size is n. And counter is the number of elements that we assume that they are in the buffer. I say assume because deleting is not associated with anything. Deleting means if you don't take the number into account, that means deletion. So if you ignore it, it is deleted from the memory. It is considered as a deleted data, although it stays in the memory as long as the power is on. So we use percent because we have ring buffer. We use modulus calculations. So if the n is 10, it is always following itself. So if you keep incrementing, it can rotate. Any questions? Okay. Okay. The consumer, on the other hand, tries to use those numbers, use those data with some waiting. If there is nothing to consume, that means if this counter is zero, that means nothing is inside. there is no element available, then wait until counter becomes at least one. When counter becomes at least one, this will move down. I should have noted that counter is a shared variable. Also, buffer is shared variable. In is. Well, then, those are the shared variables. In and out doesn't have to be. Buffer is also a shared variable. So this buffer is shared variable. If it is, if in and out, if counter is zero, do nothing. If counter is one, then go ahead. So take the element from the buffer to your local variable. Increase the output pointer, meaning that I have taken that last output is incremented. Then counter is decremented. So that one is taken. How many items in the buffer is stored in the counter value. So this works pretty nice. Producer and consumer. Data sharing. Buffer, through buffer. Array and counter. This may look fine, but there are certain problems here. One of the problem is a busy loop. This busy loop is very bad for the multiprocessing environment because you have different bursts. P1, P2, P3, P1 again, P2, and so on. So if P2 is busy waiting, it is a waste. Instead, it should exit, and P3 should follow. So this must be, this is bad, this is good, because there is busy waiting. Another thing is, when you are setting counter value, consumer may be updating the counter value at the same time, because it is concurrent. Concurrent means at the same time in theory. That means if you have two cars, this is process one, this is process two, they are being fixed concurrently. There might be some tool exchange, fine. But there is only one CPU, let's say. One CPU executes it concurrently. But here it says, get 16 screws. Screws are in the screws from the box. That works fine because getting 16 screws from the box, check box, if greater than 16, if greater than n, where n is 16, get n. So that kind of operation should be done. This one, get 10 cyclers. Checkbox, if it is greater than 10, get. If the box has 20 cyclers and they are running concurrently, what happens? This one executes first instruction. Then you have task switching. You switch to another task. Who knows? Maybe sometimes you may do task switching. So the other one checks the box. It is more than 10. So they start taking. This one takes 10 scripts. Okay. The other one executes 10 scripts. P1 fails. Birisinin mikrofonu açık. Burak, mikrofonu kapatır mısın? So do you understand? Because each action, such as counter plus plus, is load CTTC counter increment register store counter. That is the minimum assembly equivalent of changing a variable in the memory. So that may be disrupted by context switch between multitasking. So you load the context switch and next time the value is different. That's the problem. So here I am going to explain that the counter plus plus, this is interesting. Counter plus plus can be implemented by register. That is load increment store. Counter minus load decrement store in the assembly language. In C programming language, that is counter plus plus and counter minus minus. But in the assembly version, that could be the case. And due to task switching between two processes, because the timer overflows, timer says it is your time every millisecond, every 100 millisecond or so, whatever. So these two things can be executed by the single CPU as follows. First, register is equal to counter, then register is incremented, then register 2 is set to counter, register 2 is incremented, decremented, counter is saved. What happened is, normally what you expect is 565, but at the end it becomes 54. So instead of going back to its own previous value, the intermediate value is lost because the successive write is successive write, one after another write here, is performed, this value is lost. Normally, if you increment a value and decrement a value, it should be the same. But in this case, we incremented and decremented. If they are executed simultaneously, so simultaneously that timer interrupt will happen in between, very precise. It doesn't happen all the time. Then sometimes the value is wrong. That is one of the reasons where we see errors in the computer world from time to time, not always. So errors are not deterministic in the multiprocessing architectures. Shared data, shared tools in robotics, for example, sometimes causes problems. The solution is either not share that kind of data. If you don't have any sharing, synchronization is solved. You don't need to synchronize, but efficiency goes down. So if the efficiency is achieved by synchronization, and if you need that kind of relation between multiple processes, then you need to make synchronization techniques. You need to use synchronization techniques. Otherwise, due to nature of the multitasking, it may fail sometimes. That is race condition. And race condition is a famous race condition in many places. In programming, you have race condition. In logic gates, you have race condition. In here also, in assembly language and operating systems, there is also race condition, which is very interesting. So generally speaking, critical section problem is considered as a system of n process. You have n from 0 to n. Each process is changing common variable like buffer content and the counter values, etc. When one process is in critical section, no other process should be in the critical section. What is the critical section? This is the critical section. That is the critical section. Updating common variables. Updating common variables is critical section. If you are in critical section, task switching should not be performed. It is impossible because at each instruction, task switching can happen because timer interrupt can happen before each instruction. So there are two solutions: prevent timer causing interrupts, or make instructions, invent instructions so that these kind of things can be implemented in one instruction. If we implement this counting memory in one instruction, then it cannot be divided into two. We call it as atomic instructions. If we can invent atomic instructions, we can solve many problems connected to it by using those atomic instructions. So a critical section problem is a protocol to solve this issue. What is the issue? When one process is in critical section, no other can be in the same area. In the previous lecture, I was giving the example of toilet. This toilet example, you have two processes. only one person can go into toilet at a time. You cannot go together. Just must be satisfied. How are you going to satisfy it? One idea is put a sign here. Put a sign here so that when this person goes in, he will flip the sign and this will see that, this will check the sign. If P2 checks the sign, he will not go because there is somebody inside. So each one, P1, while busy, P2 while busy, they will check the sign. If the busy sign is there or red, green, whatever, they will wait until it is cleared by someone inside. There is a person inside. P3. P3 is inside actually. So as he or she moves out, it will flip the busy sign, and then either of them will go in. This looks nice, but the question is now reduced to how are you going to check the busy sign and how are you going to flip the sign? If as a two people go there and flip together, it doesn't work. Who goes first? So there must be an ordering mechanism. And flipping the sign should not be divided, because these are P1, P2. They look like different people, but they are executed by the same CPU. So one is executed, then another executed, then another executed. In time. So as you go while busy, set busy, do, I am not explaining what he does, then free busy. When P2 frees, when P2 executes this command, P1 can go in. But since going in and going out is not regulated nicely, you can put a key to somewhere. Key to the toilet. Each process goes to key first. If they can get key, they know that they can go in. If key is not there, then they will wait. So key methodology is a little bit better because it prevents contentions inside the toilet. Key is in the secretary's room. If the key is not there, you automatically realize that someone has taken it and doing his business or her business. You wait. You keep checking the key. if there are more than one people checking the key, what's going to happen? There must be an ordering mechanism. There must be timestamp mechanism so that early people should have more priority. When the key is present, first one takes the key and then goes into the toilet. Meaning this is the critical section. That's the shared area. Each process has entry section, exit section, and remainder section. So, as I said, set, free, and check parts are named as exit sections, remainder sections, and entry sections. So business stuff is there. Each process, each process has entry section, critical section, where it changes the common variable, then exit section, and then remainder section, the whatever is necessary. And it is repeated. So concurrent processes work all the time. They exchange data. Exchanging data requires some manipulation of indexes in certain places. That manipulation contains critical section and some account management, counting or setting values, flags, etc. Those are named as entry section and exit section. Flipping the free sign, for example, is the exit section and entry section. Any questions so far? So this one can be implemented like, while turn is equal to J, while it is the other people, Buyurun efendim method. Siz buyurun efendim. So each side, this is for PI. Each side says other should go first, but there will be another person all the time. So while turn is equal to J, wait. If the other person gives the ball to you, if the other person says you go by saying turn is equal to J on the other side, you can go in. You can do critical section operations. After finishing critical section operations, you say, I am done with it. And you, the other person, can go. So this is workable and it's a continuous loop. You go first. When you have multiple processes, you need to also include a counter, which will be seen now. Counter must be accompanied with the turn, so that the ordering is also available. Critical section problem requires certain conditions to be solved. One, if process PI, that's the first one, is mutual exclusion. If process PI is in critical section, no other process can go into critical section. So no one can be in the toilet simultaneously. with other person. So only one person can go in because it's critical section. So you should prevent other processes from going into critical section if at least one process is there. Second, if no process is in the critical section, but there is one person going, wants to go in, there must be a mechanism to select one person and put it into the critical section. Meaning that if there is nobody in the toilet and there are three people trying to get into toilet, siz buyurun efendim. Siz buyurun method should not fail. If everybody keeps saying siz buyurun, siz buyurun, siz buyurun, siz buyurun, siz buyurun, siz buyurun, then nobody can enter. Therefore, progress condition should be satisfied. The method should progress and take one person into critical section. Saying just you go first cannot solve the problem. You go first is good for two people, but if two people start saying you go first at the beginning, it is not a solution. Third, again, if there are number of processes waiting, there must be an ordering, a legitimate ordering, so that maximum number of waiting should be limited to relatively n number of steps. After n number of steps, you need to be able to go into critical section. So limitless waiting is not allowed. Again, it is not allowed in toilets. I mean, if you are waiting in the line, and there is a limit, so cannot wait forever because you are kind of you go first person. And speed of the relative speed of the processes is not important here. You can spend a lot of time in toilet, but still have the same priority. You may, but normally there is no assumption. But this is also important. It is prohibited to die in the toilet. So you have to do your business. You have to proceed. So speed, non-zero speed is necessary. It could be slow, but still it could finish. This critical section issues can be solved in two main approaches. One, kind approaches. Other one is rude approaches. Kind approaches require participants to give way to others. So processes are preempted if they're as they are running in kernel mode. If it takes too long, so that means critical region is not moving forward, then you can stop and move to another process. That is preemption. if you wait until process exits or voluntarily blocks itself from the toilet or from processing, from the consuming or producing process, then it is called as non-preemptive. Non-preemptive requires all participant processes to be kind to each other. So well written, if they are well written and bug free, it can work. But if there is a bug or if they are not kind to each other, then preemption may be necessary. So those are approaches. And you should choose one of them, not both. Algorithmic solution, Peterson solution, is actually a description of the solution that we just explained. Two processes, P1, P2, has turn and flag. Flag means I want to go. I want to go. The toilet example is a good example. I want to go to toilet. Turn means I am in the toilet. So who is in? Who wants to go? So each side, presumably, each side will check who wants to go. If one of them wants to go, turn is taken. If two of them wants to go, then the first one will take it. Turn indicates whose turn is it to enter the critical section, and flag is used to indicate the process is ready to enter the critical section. Flag true means process PI is ready to go to toilet, ready to go into critical section. Critical section means changing the common variable, changing the buffer counter, that kind of problematic shared variables. So the solution is set the flag true for each process. I want to go to toilet, set. Give turn to other. So say sen buyur to the other side. Then keep waiting until the other side is out. If the other side is out already, no problem, you can go. If the other side is in, you wait until he or she comes out. So while flag is on the other side, if other side wants to go and other side is in, I want to go in and I am in, this is my turn, then wait. If both of them are violated, execute critical section, reduce the flag, and finish. You say turn J. Who is going to make turn I? The other person will say turn I. Since other person says sen buyur, okay, you can go in. So whoever says turn at the end gives the way to other. But these checkings and turnings also creates problems. Turn is equal to J. So load turn. Load J. Add. Store. Turn. It requires 4 instructions. So what if you have interrupt in the middle? Then it will also fail. Therefore, these needs to be atomic. We need to have atomic instructions to work on these problems. Although this is kind of correct, but it still has certain limitations. So 3 requirements are met. Progress is satisfied. Mutual exclusion here is satisfied. Bounded weighting is also satisfied. At some point, even if 2 person is out, anybody wants in will go in after the other one, or as a first one. As a first one or second one, you should go into critical section. However, critical regions are in reality, because of this race condition problem, most synchronization is done by synchronization hardware. Synchronization hardware is provided by atomic instructions. Atomic instruction means non-interruptible instructions. Non-interruptible instructions are very good for synchronization. Also, there are mechanisms that are supported by operating systems and CPUs for lockings. So there are locks, keys, physical locks in CPU, so that when you lock, it satisfies mutual exclusion in hardware. That is provided. If you have single processor system, a small microprocessor and running multiple things, one and other, you can disable interrupts. That is sometimes visible in assembly programs. You have an assembly program, and at some point, interrupt occurs. Okay? Any kind of interrupt. What is the thing that you execute? Interrupt service routine. In the interrupt service routine, some of the interrupt service routines, the first instruction is mask. First instruction masks interrupts because it says you are in the interrupt service routine. Interrupts are masked. So interrupt within an interrupt is not allowed. If I am in the interrupt, I am going to finish these instructions and then come back. And if interrupt is waiting, it should wait until I re-enable, unmask the interrupts. So some processors can disable interrupts so that critical regions interrupts are blocked. Therefore, race condition is eliminated. So preemption during critical region, is eliminated. However, when you have multiple processors or multiple cores, that is too inefficient. So you need to use locks and keys and other atomic instructions in software to support synchronization rather than pure masking of the interrupts. Evet. Typical example. Get the lock. If you can get the lock, go to toilet, release the lock, and wash your hands. You can wash your hands without interrupting other people, because there are multiple water faucets. So this is the critical region. So how am I going to get lock and set lock, release lock and get lock things must be implemented atomically. Somehow they have to be done atomically. And if the lock is processed successfully, that means critical region can only be entered by only one process at a time. So it will be nice. That is one instruction. Is famous instruction is test and set instruction. In the test and set instruction, it is like this. Dokunduğunu al. After recent COVID-19 pandemics in markets, they say if you touch to something, you should buy it. So test and set instruction is like that. There is a single instruction which returns the value of a memory register or location. And at the same time, it sets it, regardless of whether it is zero or one. So if it is zero, it returns zero and makes it to one. If it is one, it returns one and makes it to one. So this is before, this is after, this is before, this is after. So when you test and set this before value, your result will be zero. If you test and set this value one, and your result will be one. Dokunduğunu alıyorsun. Bir daha dokunursan zaten torbada. O zaman one geliyor yani. Peki ne zaman sıfır yapıyorsun? How do you set it to zero? With another instruction. So you can clear that manually, but if you want to read it, it is yours. So if you want to, when you check the key, when you check the key to the toilet, if you see it, it is yours because it is there. So atomic instruction is guaranteed. So it is guaranteed that if anybody sees the key, it is taken. So two people cannot see the key as available, and one person attempts to take it, another person also attempts to take it but cannot get it. That is the race condition. When we implement it in atomic way, two people cannot see it at the same time, because if one person sees it as a free, it is atomically said that seeing and getting is connected, cannot be divided. I think it is clear. I explained it very nice. I liked it. I liked the example too. So it is atomically executed, returns the original value of the past parameter, sets the new value of the past parameter to true. Dokunduğunu alıyorsun yani. So, solution of the critical second problem, the race condition issue with the test and set instruction. Hocam buyur, dinliyorum.
Hocam çok kısa atomik, tam olarak ben atomi anlayamadım ya. Bir daha tekrar edebilir miyiz diyecektim.
Şimdi bak, olabilir tabii. Şöyle. Şurada mesela törn eşittir j diyoruz ya. Bu törn eşittir j'in assembly dilinde compiler'dan çıktıktan sonraki hali şunlardan oluşuyor. Atomik değil. Şu arada task switching olabilir mi? Olabilir. Neden olabilir? Task switching neyle gerçekleşir? Timer'la. Timer devamlı sayıyor. Yeter abi diyor, öbürüne geçiyor. Yeter abi diyor, öbürüne geçiyor. Değil mi? Allah'ın işine bak sen. Tam burada yeter abi diyor. Burada yeter abi dediğinde öbür prosesinde burasına gelirse bu sefer şu load J store'dan önce gerçekleşecek ve böylece arada bir tane value kaynayacak. Yani saat 11 olacak. Saat 11'den sonra 12'yi atlayıp gece 1'e geçecek bir saat sonra. Çünkü hem gün değişiyor hem saat değişiyor. Saat programını yanlış yazdıysan gün değişiminde tekrar saati değiştireceği için iki tane birden değiştirecek. Bu da benzer bir problem. Dolayısıyla bir bakmışsın saat gece 1. Hani 12 olacaktı? İki tane increment var bir yerlerde. İkisi de increment çalıştı. Üst üste geldi incrementler. Böyle bir şey olacak. Bunu engellemek için bu tarz bir şeyi, turn eşittir C gibi bir şeyi bölünemez yapman lazım. Bölünemez yapman için ya interruptları kapatacaksın dedik. Interruptları kapatırsan herkes barış içinde çalışır. Zaten o zaman işte, interruptsız işletim sistemi susuz ağaca benzer. Olmaz yani. Dolayısıyla onu yapamazsın. Ne yapacaksın? O zaman atomic instruction yapacaksın ki turn eşittir J diye bir instruction yapacaksın. Özel. Ona benzer instructionlar yapacaksın. Onların üzerine yükleneceksin. Onları kullanacaksın ki dokunduğunu alasın. Yani iki kişi aynı anda anahtara saldırmasın. İki kişinin eli anahtarda çarpışmasın. Anlatabildim mi?
Yani hocam tek satırda tek line'da oluyormuş gibi, yani araya interrupt giremiyor
tek,
gibi mi?
Tek line, tek line'da ama tek assembly line'ında. Şey line değil, C line'ı değil, assembly line'ı.
Anladım.
Compiler çıktısındaki line'da. Şimdi atomic yaptığında test and set log bakıyorsun sıfır. Şimdi yapmak istiyorsun ya. Sıfır. Sıfırsa bekliyorsun. Peki ne zaman yürüyorsun? Bir başkası diğer taraf. Yani tuvaletteki adam anahtarı geri bıraktığı anda bir kereye mahsus olmak üzere, bölünemez bir şekilde bir kereye mahsus olmak üzere burada bir sıfır görüyorsun. Az bir sıfır görüyorsun ama görünür görünmez onu bir yapıp yürüyorsun. Şu probleme düşmüyorsun. Ya bu sıfırmış da ben bunu bir yapayım falan demeye kalkıştığında atomik değilse bu uzun sürüyor. Okuduğum şey yaptım. O arada başka biri daha. Diyelim ki P1 P1, P2, P3 var. Şimdi bu tutuyordu, tuvaletteydi. Bu çıktı, tamam mı? Bu çıktı, turn'ı free yaptı. Bunlar ikisi free'yi while, bu da şey yapıyor, while busy. Bu da while busy yapıyor. Anlaştık mı? Şimdi bu herif yaptı, yaptı, yaptı. Busy eşittir false yaptı, tamam mı? Bu, soldaki örnekten ayrı yapıyorum. Busy eşittir false yaptı. Hangisi yürür? P2 mi, P3 mü? Bilemeyiz. Yine bilemeyiz. Öbürünü de bilemeyiz. Ama şu problem var. While busy derken arkasından busy eşittir true yapman gerekiyor. Ki bu girmesin artık. Tamam mı? Biraz öncekinde öyleydi. Şimdi sen bunu kontrol ettin. Anahtarı kontrol ettin. Anahtarı cebine koyuncaya kadar bu arada karar verdiğinde bu herif ilerleyebilir. Atomik olması onu engelliyor. Şu ikisini bire birleştiriyor. Böylece o bir instruction'da yapılıyor. Onu birisi yaptıysa artık orada bir daha time sharing falan hikayesi olmuyor. Bunu çok benzeri bir örneğini şeyde gördüm ben. Robotik tezgahlarda tool sharing ile ilgili matkap uçlarının paylaşımı. Matkap uçlarını alıyor şeyler. Robotik kollar. Bir matkap ucu işte şey olursa, kullanılıyor olursa öbürü onu kullanamıyor falan. O şekilde de şeyi var. Critical section işleri var. Tam almaya kalkışma hikayesini. Ben şu şeyi alacağım diyor. İşte 3 milimetre matkabı oradan alacağım diye bildiriyor diğer herkese. Onu alması lazım. Aynı anda diğeri bu da boş deyip o da saldırırsa iki şey çarpışıyor havada. Kol. O yüzden yani alıyorum der demez artık bir daha başka birinin onu soramaması lazım. O yüzden test and set kullanıyoruz. That's it. I think that's understandable. So test and set instruction, atomic instruction. Based on this, we can construct synchronization hardware. And when you have P1, P2, P3, P4, the second thing is to make an ordering. Choose systematic so that there is an order, there is a queuing mechanism among those who want to participate in the critical section. Next problems are solving that ordering, meaning bounded waiting. Principle. Another example is compare and swap. That's also helpful. Check whether they are equal. Test and swap. Check whether they are equal. And also replace them. That is if the value is this whole function is executed in one instruction, such as you have A, you have B, compare swap AB. This is one instruction. So task switching cannot happen. A and B is replaced. And then equality is also checked in one instruction. Compare and swap. So using that, you can exchange waiting order numbers and also make tests at the same time, so that critical things cannot be divided into two, causing race conditions. Again, atomicity is the critical issue here. If they are atomic, if this instruction is atomic, we can use it in synchronization problems. So using solution, using compare and swap, there is lock. This is the value, expected and new value. Value and expected and value is compared, new value is set. So this is test, this is current, this is new. This is returned. And other two is replaced. So check the lock. If it is zero, turn it to one. Check the lock. If it is zero, turn it to one. If it is one, wait. Because not equal to zero. If the lock is zero, set it to zero and move. Do the critical section. Set the lock to zero, free the lock so that other can go. Freeing the lock is not that important because since only one person is in the toilet, bringing back the key is automatically executed by only one person. So the problem is taking the key. So taking the key should be atomic, and here it is atomic. Check the lock against zero. If it is zero, turn it to one and also go in at once. So with n processes, there is a bounded waiting part that must be addressed. This is the most complicated one. In order to go into critical section, first you indicate that in the array, I am trying to go to toilet, trying to go in. Key is true. While there is while I is waiting and key is available, check for the lock. If lock is free, automatically lock is done. If lock is free, set it to one, then declare yourself as not waiting, because it will be used for determining bounded ordering. Then J equals I plus one percent n. So who is next algorithm? While who is next is not waiting, it is similar to checking whether there are people in front of you. If there are people in front of you, wait. If the J equals to I, that means it is you who should go. And you use if there is nobody else waiting, then you switch to lock equals to false. Then declare yourself as finished and exit. So details are not crucial, but this part shows bounded waiting. So it's basically a queue management, circular queue management. If everybody finishes, it's my turn. So turn management part. And at the top, there is an atomic instruction to get the key and go in. That's basically it. Fortunately, programming languages and operating systems provide tools for these things. So they have implemented these as a libraries. So you don't need to write a code like this. You use constructs called as semaphores for this purpose. So one of the things are named as mutual exclusion lock. So acquire and release can be implemented. A lock is defined by the operating system. Operating system designers make them. So when you, such as mutex, Ali, okay, and then Ali dot acquire gets the mutex. Ali dot releases the mutex. So anything in between is ensured that it is atomic. These codes are added by the operating system. It is managed by the operating system. All you do is acquire and release. So it is operating system level locks. However, using locks, release and acquire, when you do only these, it requires busy waiting. So this while lock is false, this approach requires busy waiting because there is a while loop to keep the process from moving further. So it is called as spin lock because the program counter is spinning. The CPU is running, executing something. So we don't want that. We want CPU to give control, process to give control to other processes. And when it is necessary, we want processes to wake up. So sleep and wake up is much better. That is provided by the semaphore. So this acquire and release is acquire while available, busy wait. Then available is false. Do your job and release. Available is true. So this is simple. This is acquire, this is release. And in the process, you acquire lock, do your critical section, release lock and remainder section. So acquire lock requires busy waiting. But still, it's okay. Semaphore is more sophisticated. It contains wait and signal constructs. When you wait, it could be busy at the beginning. It blocks the procedure. So it's P1. When you have wait S, it blocks, it stops. Some other process, somewhere else, should signal. When you see the signal, this one moves forward. I have a toy, mechanical toy, to show you in the class. Those are small mechanical wound clockwork cars, multiple cars on the same platform. If one car comes to some place, it stops until another car goes from another place. They are connected from the bottom. So one car, the movement of one car releases the other car mechanically by mechanical connection from somewhere else. If we had a physical class, I would show it to you, but I will send a video of the same toy. It is not meant to be an educational toy for operating system classes, but it is actually very good for this explaining this semaphore issue. So rather than busy waiting, semaphores use block and wake up functions. So when you execute block functions, process sleeps. When you execute wake up functions, process starts again. So busy waiting is eliminated. I am going to review semaphores in the next lecture as well. For today, I think this one is sufficient. So if you have any questions, let me know. Resul gitti. Evet. Şurada block, şurada wake up. We have counting semaphores and non-counting semaphores, and I am going to explain those next week.